Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall. But you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won. For you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. Still in your hands, this is my confidence. You never failed me yet. I know the night. I know the night won't last. Your word will come to pass. Your praise again.
I'll sing your praise again.
Jesus.
Jesus, you're still enough.
Keep me within your love.
My heart will sing your praise again.
Your promise. Still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed me yet.
I never will.
come together, strangers.
I sing.
Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross.
Song here. This is one we've sung a few times. All right, Your Love Awakens Me.
There were walls between us, by the cross you came.
Thanks, worship team. You may be seated for a moment. Welcome to church today. Welcome via live stream today. God bless you. Well, we're getting good news. We're getting better and better. The latest ruling is that we've gone from 4x4 distancing. So if your families live together, they can sit together, of course. But and just remember to spread out a bit. But we've gone from 4x4 rule now to 2x2, which is good. And you, if you're fully vaxxed, you're allowed to sing under your mask. So I won't say anything else, but I'll get myself in trouble. But you got a mask on. Nobody can tell you're singing anyway. So just keep it reasonable. And so we're got all that happening, so it's good. And the just remember to clean your hands. Sometimes I might shake a hand, but if I do, I clean it straight away and don't touch my face. So if you happen to, someone sticks it out and you get it, I do not like to not shake a hand, you know, but usually I'll just give it a clean. So just if we all abide by the rules and everything, keep ourselves safe and everything, and we'll just keep pushing ahead. Now, we can probably fit in here over 100 now. So we've got 200 seats. So that should cater for the size of our church at the moment. And good, because we don't get them all here at once. And so it's all the way it usually works. So that's all good. So we don't have to send out invitations and, you know, the things that some churches have to do. We just say, just come and you'll fit in. And we've also got the foyer out there. We can fit more people. And 24, we could probably fit 2x2, probably fit about 40 or so out there. So, and you can watch the screen, put the doors open. So plenty of room for revival. Bring your friends. And we're not quite back to normal, but getting a bit better. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Tuesday the 10th at 10 a.m. on the 9th. That's already gone by. So Friday night will be the next ladies' meeting on the 19th of November. That's from 7 to 9 p.m. at the church here. So Jacqueline will be looking after that. They had a good ladies' meeting last one. And December the 3rd, there will be a Christmas celebration with the ladies' meeting from 7 to 9 p.m. And at Christmas time, Christmas Day is Saturday, so we're going to have a one-hour service here, which is always a nice service. It's just 1 hour. We go from 10 to 11, and then you can get home and have your Christmas dinner and so forth. Make it part of the day, you know. Open your presents in the morning and come down and celebrate the Lord for an hour, and then go home and have your dinner or whatever you're doing, and then have a sleep in the afternoon. Sounds good after eat everything. And Christmas Day, that'll be on. And I think the Sunday after that, or the Sunday before, we'll see how things go and what the rules are. We may try and get some food in and have a bit of a celebration in the church or something like that. So a bit of a Christmas party. So God bless. Just a short and very quick testimony. Derek sharing this morning. What's your sermon this morning, Pastor Derek?
The musings of a thoughtful man.
The musings of a thoughtful man. Do we include women in this too?
No, I'm sexist.
You're sexy. What did you say? You're sexy.
Oh, yeah, I'm sexy.
Yeah, okay. I'm being cheeky. They'll defrock me. I am normal. So that'll be happening, and it'll all be good. And I've lost my train of thought, Derek.
testimony,
yeah. There's always good things happening, isn't there? There's been enough bad things happening. A couple of weeks ago, and I've asked permission of Peter Corkman to share this story. You know how God moves, especially in the areas of giving. And I'd especially like to, when we have to do the tithes and offerings, so it's a little bit of a testimony about giving and being a generous type person. It'd probably be good before the offering and the tithes. The other day, we all know Nola, don't we? She lives out at Braidwood and haven't seen her for a while, but God bless her. She, Peter rang me up and said Nola was getting a new car, a little Volkswagen one, and that she had another one she wanted to give away. And would the church like it to think about who you might like to give it to? And I said, well, not back a car, you know. It's a good car. It did have a few Ks, 300,000, but barely run in. It's only 7 years old and a really, really good car. There's a young couple sit up here. Mark, if you're watching, Mark and Ruby, they come to the church, have been coming along recently, and the last 6 months they've got saved, and I'm going to marry them in April, and they're up-and-coming couple in the church, and lovely young couple, work down at Lowe's. And I popped in and I was praying. This is how God works. I thought, I won't take it to the board about the car. I'll just pray about it. Well, I won't take it yet, but I'll just pray about it and see what the Lord says, because I didn't know where it was to go. So I was walking into the mall and I said to the Lord, Lord, would you give this car to somebody who needs it? And secondly, Lord, somebody that's generous. And I know Mark and Ruby are generous young people, and they had lost a car, actually, through, I won't go into their personal, they were struggling a lot and having a lot of things happening. And she's just got a new job and things are working out for them and God's starting to bless them. And I know they were coming up and putting finance in here and talking about tithing or something. I don't know whether it was an offering or a tithe, but anyway, I just thought, you know, they've got a good heart and they're generous. And so that I asked for that and that got fulfilled. And then I thought, and somebody that needs a supernatural touch from the Lord to know that God is providing for them, that God is looking after them. And I walked into Lowe's and there's Mark, and I said, oh, hi, Mark, and he popped up, and we had a chat, and I said, how's things going? Have you got a car yet? He said, yeah, we've got one. We had to get rid of the other one because we couldn't afford it, and, you know, and we had no work and everything. And sorry, I hope I'm not talking out of order, Mark, but I didn't ask you, did I? But anyway, what happened was... he said, oh, Ruby's got some work, but we need another car because we've got to go to different workplaces. And I said, oh, that's fantastic. You know, you're getting work. Things are working out for you. And I just filled it out. And then he fulfilled those three things I just prayed for 2 minutes before as I walked in. And there he was. And the Lord told me that was who to give the car to. And I just filled him out. And then he said... oh, they want one. I said, look, how would you like a car? A person in the church, a generous person, has given the church a car to give to somebody. And they said, what? I said, you should have seen Mark's face. Mark, your face was priceless. And anyway, they're going to pick it up through the week. And isn't that good? We're into giving. We give the Lord a hand and we're into giving away cars now, and Heather was able to give hers away when, you know, she got another one. So that was good. And so we're all learning to be good people in that area. So we're going to bring our tithes and offerings this morning and, you know, learning to be generous, learning to be because we can, or even when you can't. If you've only got carrots, well... you know, throw some carrots in the offering. And in India, I know when you go, they often bring some eggs or different things and people put in, you know, whatever they can, and because they're generous. So there's different ways to give there. Basically, you can direct deposit on that BSB number. And thank you for everyone that's done that, because we've been able to budget, we've been able to look after our missionaries, we've been able to look after the church, we're able to get projects done in the church, and it's been a wonderful thing that everyone's doing. And there's envelopes out there if you wish to give to any offerings to the church. So we understand the difference between tithes, offerings and alms, okay? And legs. I don't want to talk about legs, but tithes are go to your local church, and I'm not going into a message on it. They go to your storehouse where you come. Offerings can go anywhere really, to any ministry or anyone you feel. If you want to foster a child as an offering over and above, we do have Margaret Pashley, we help support as a missionary, and she can foster children too, so why not do it through the church? But if you got someone else and you got on your heart, that's fine, whatever. And alms go to the poor. So sometimes you might feel to help the poor. And even in Queanbeyan, I've known people in our church that have seen someone going through the checkout and bought their groceries for them or done something, not because they can, but because God spoke to their heart to do it. And so sometimes you can help the poor or do something and have that sort of lifestyle. Amen. So let's stand as we confess this confession this morning. The Bible says, not quite there, but Hebrews 12:1-2, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great crowd of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which easily ensnares us. This is not the confession. Let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. And Psalm 16 says, I have set the Lord always before me, because he is at my right hand and I'll not be moved. It is my right hand, I shall not be moved. And I remember that scripture about Hebrews 12, that we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, and some people preach that at being the saints in heaven or the ones that have gone before, but I like to personalize that we are surrounded by people who witness what we do and what we say. And so we are surrounded, so our behavior and the things that we do say a lot about us, because we can preach the gospel without saying words, you know. I think it's good to say words. And we run that race for Jesus. So let's have a look at the confession, and let's say this together. As I give in today's offering, I fix my eyes on Jesus, my Lord, my Saviour and my Redeemer, my very present help in time of trouble, my song in the valley, my light in the darkness. My eyes are fixed by faith. I'll not be moved. I'll not be distracted. My giving is one way I used to say, Jesus, I trust you and know you're working on my behalf. And he really does. And let me say, the church is not about only wanting your money. People in the community say that. We are not about that. Never have been, never will be. It's all about getting the gospel out. Amen. It's all about raising up disciples and all of that. And unfortunately, it takes money. As my Uncle Jeff used to say, it's only paper. So, but it can do a lot of good work. Not even paper, no, it's gone digital, just about. Well, let's come forward as musicians play something to do that this morning. And God bless you and thank you, everyone.
mended and whole, empty-handed but not forsaken. I've been set free, I've been set free. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. I can see you now. Oh, I can see the love in your eyes, laying yourself down. The broken to for we trust in our God, and through His unfailing love, we will not be shaken, we will not be shaken, we will not be shaken, we trust. For we trust in our God, and through His unfailing love, we will not be shaken, we will not be shaken, we will not be shaken. to your hands, I commit again all I am for you, Lord. You hold my world in the palm of your hands, and I am yours forever. Jesus, I believe in you. Jesus, I belong to you. You're the reason that I live and the reason that I sing. With all I am, I walk with you wherever you go, through tears and joy. I'll trust in you, and I will live in all of your ways and your promises forever.
I will worship.
will worship you. Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and pain for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are. cross as you weep for the crown. Tell the world of the treasure you found.
Hallelujah. Morning, church. How are we? We good? Nice to see you all. And welcome to any visitors, or hello out to the, what they call that, the Twitter sphere or whatever. But before I start, let's start with the prayer. I thank you, Lord. We've come today, Lord, just to gather, Lord, as a family, Lord, to worship and to praise you, Father, to lift up your name, to thank you, Lord, to give you thanks for everything you've done for us, Lord. And we praise your mighty name, Lord. We thank you for the miracles that you're doing on a daily basis, Lord. And we thank you, Father God, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, the musings of a thoughtful man, in case you didn't know, that's me. Not quite sure how thoughtful I am, but I thought I'd give it a go. So we've been in lockdown for quite a while, and that's given me time to think, to do a lot of thinking. Now, if you're like me, overdoing the thinking lark can lead to some fairly disturbing places. That's if you're not disciplined. Okay, so we can all get carried away with thoughts, and we can all go to places where we probably shouldn't go. There's a saying about idle hands being the devil's playthings, which I believe is attributed to Benjamin Franklin, according to my mate Google. And I believe, and this can also be true of idle minds, that if you're not disciplined enough, the devil can grab a hold of your mind and take you places you don't really want to go. But there's one thing that kept coming to me at this while I've been thinking. And this was this. Can I just play that little video thing? Hopefully it works. And, oh yes, why, oh why? And, you know, I think we can all sort of go with that. Why, oh why? Now, I should be an expert on the whys. Because I get plenty of practice. I have a 7-year-old granddaughter who I run home on a regular basis. And she will ask me some interesting questions, as 7-year-olds do. And Poppy, being a wise man, will give her deep and meaningful answers. And then she'll put her head on one side, and you can basically just see the gears going chugga, 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 chugga. And she'll either go, why? And then, of course, Poppy has to then give another deep and meaningful answer. And then again, the head goes on one side and she's... And then it'll either be, okay, let's go on to something else. I've digested that. Or it'll be another why. And on it'll go. And between Queen Bian Library and Gugong, there's a lot of time for whys. And but you know something? I just love it. I just love it. You know that it's something I don't think I'll ever tire of, until the time when I don't need to run her anymore. But hopefully that won't be for quite some time. And, I find at this time that I've been playing that part of the 7-year-old, and God's been playing the Poppy role. And the first scripture that came to mind, I think, it's found in John chapter 16. And I think, God's telling me, well, eventually told me, or eventually I heard or understood. He said, I've already told you. What do you want to know? Yeah, I've already told you. And this is what it says. In the world you will have tribulation. And that's part of, I'm going to leave it there, okay? In the world you will have tribulation. Now, tribulation is described in the dictionary as follows. It's a cause of great trouble or suffering, and it can, all those things, problems, troubles, difficulties, misfortunes, suffering, hardship, misery, it goes on. It also has a second meaning, a state of great trouble or suffering, and again you get the trouble, the worry, the anxiety, the burden. Afflictions, ordeals, trials, adversities, mishaps, misadventures, suffering, distress, misery, wretchedness, unhappiness, sadness, heartache, woe, grief, pain. Oh, the list goes on. And it's not a very pretty picture, is it? Now that I've got you all in a real state of melancholy. Didn't mean to, but these things are true. And the scriptures tell us that these things will happen. And God says, well, why are you surprised, Derek? Why are you surprised? It's in the word. Don't you believe the word, Derek? Oh, yeah, yes, Lord, I do. You have to hit me over the head with a lump of 4x2 sometimes, but I eventually get it. But see, Jesus wants us to know that these things are going to happen. But he also wants us to know where they come from. I think at this stage or this time, a lot of people are blaming God for what's happening. And let me tell you, it's got nothing to do with God. Okay? Yeah, these things happen and God allows things to happen for a specific purpose. You know, he allowed things to happen to Job. Job was a great righteous man. But God allowed the devil to test him. You see, the scripture tells us that the devil is the accuser of the brethren. And he goes before God even now accusing us of things. Okay? And things can happen in our lives so that we can understand the love of God and how God brings us through. We've been through a few things in my life and God has always been faithful. As long as, if I'm faithful, God is faithful. And I've kept my eyes on the Lord and the Lord has always brought me through. And he will continue to do so. So there is this. See, chapter 10, verse 10 tells us this. The thief comes only to kill, steal and destroy. See, that's where it's all coming from. It's all coming from the devil. He's out there to kill, steal and destroy. And you, good people, are in his gun sights. Like it or not, if you're a Christian, you're his enemy. Like it or not. But he's out there. And he's trying to destroy you. And in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8, the apostle gives us another clue, I guess, as to who the author of all this mayhem is. It says, your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Yeah. Now, I did read something some years back about a roaring lion. And it seems that the old lion, who's a little bit like me, can't run very fast and can't chew very much. But his sole role is to stand there and roar. And all the animals that they're hunting hear the roar. And what's your immediate reaction to a lion roaring? Well, if you've got any sense, you run the other way, don't you? As fast as you can. And that's exactly what his role is. He stands there and roars. You run like crazy in the opposite direction, right into the arms of the rest of the pride, which are all the females that do all the hunting, apparently. There's something in that, I'm not quite sure, but we'll leave it for the time being. And you know, so that's what he is. The devil's an old, gummy old lion roaring his head off, and we all flee in the opposite direction, right into the arms of his cohorts. So next time he roars at you, roar back. It'll be good. You see, I have been selective in the parts of the scripture I've used, because I believe that we tend to focus on the positive bits of scripture. And the bits we don't like, we tend to, you know, let's forget that bit. We'll put that in the too-hard basket and we won't worry about it, all right? But it's all there for a reason. The good bits, the bad bits, the hard to understand bits, they're all there. It's all there for a reason. We need to know and be prepared for what is going to happen. Because God treats us all the same. Jesus speaks in Matthew 5, verse 45, and he says this: he causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. You know, and this led me to another why question. If he treats us all the same in the here and now, then what's the point? Is there a point? Well, yes, there is. So we've been declaring Psalm 91 since the beginning of the pandemic over the church. In our prayer meetings and what have you, we've been praying Psalm 91. And this is what it says in verse 8. You will observe with your eyes and see the punishment of the wicked. Okay? You will see. We tend to focus on the here and now. We're very much a people who, what you see, if you can see it, okay, fine. But beyond that, we don't tend to give it much thought. Well, I don't. I've had the rest of you, but anyway. But we're not just here and now people, are we? We are people of eternity. And we need to start getting our eyes off the here and now and onto the eternity. Because for certain, at the end, that is what is going to happen. You see all those flames and fire and what have you? Well, like it or not, folks, that's where people who don't know Jesus are going. And, you know, they don't like to hear that, but that's, and we don't like to teach it. But that's never us. That is the reality of what will happen at the end. At the end of the end, whenever that might be. Who knows when that might be. And in Psalm 1 verse 6 he says this: for the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked leads to destruction. I was trying to find, I know there's a scripture where David is complaining, well, I guess he's complaining, he's saying to the Lord, you know, look at all these wicked people. They flourish. They do this, and you know they're horrible people. But they tend to get what they want. They do all this, and what's the point? And then God takes him to the temple, and God shows him what's going to happen. And he says, and then he understands what's going to happen. You can have a terrible, you know, you can be a terrible person and get away with it, and you can have all the riches and all the things under the sun, but there's one thing for certain. There is one thing for certain: you can't take it with you. I don't care what kind of life you have now, you can't take that with you. You stand before God the same as everybody else, and God says, what have you done with your life? And it's up to you. You can say, well, I did this for you, Lord, or I did this. Or you can say, well, I had a good time. I drank a lot of beer. I went to a lot of parties, and God will go, I'm glad you enjoyed yourself, because now that's the end of it. You're gone. I wasn't going that way, but anyway. We get to Psalm 37, verse 18, and this is what this says. The blameless spend their days under the Lord's care, and their inheritance will endure forever. In times of disaster, they will not wither. In days of famine, they will enjoy plenty. And you know, we can look around, and I can say without a doubt, without any problem whatsoever, that is what the Lord does. He does that for you, you know. you know, I'm amazed at how things go, how things are in our life, how things we are able to do the things now in retirement that we did when I was earning, three times as much. But God is so gracious, and God allows us to do these things, and we have never been in want. Ever. Time after time in Scripture, you will see that the righteous and the unrighteous are going through the same trials and tribulations. But the Lord delivers the righteous person from all the conflicts if we do not lose heart. Psalm 34, verse 19, onwards says this: the righteous person may have troubles, or may have many troubles, but the Lord delivers them or him from them all. He protects all his bones. Not one of them will be broken. Evil will slay the wicked, and the foes of the righteous will be condemned. The Lord will rescue his servants. No one who takes refuge in him will be condemned. You know, these are the words of God, and these are the words that we need to take a hold of and grasp and really let them seep into us. You know, the Word of God is no good to you unless it's in you. Okay? And now there's a difference, okay? There is head knowledge. Well, you can have all the head knowledge in the world. You can go on to, what's that TV program I watch in the afternoons? I can't remember now, but anyway, they ask a lot of silly questions, and if you answer them right, you get points and all that kind of stuff. But that's all head knowledge. But God knowledge is in the heart. Head knowledge is going to do you a little bit of good. Heart knowledge is going to save you. And get it from the head to the heart. It's not very far. It's further in some people because I'm short, but the distance is. But sometimes people just don't get it, you know. That's something that I find so frustrating. I do. I get very frustrated, you know. How can you say that this thing, you know, this beautiful world, just happened by mischance? It just was a sheer accident. Get real. How could you? But people do. I was looking. Yeah. I get mad at the TV because I'm looking at these things that are supposed to be uplifting, and they're all talking about how we all came out of a microbe, and I quickly hit the off button. Now, you know, the thing is, there's an old saying, I guess, and it says your attitude determines your altitude. And so one of the hardest scriptures to put into practice is the one found in James chapter 1 verse 2. It goes like this: consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds. Pure joy? Pure joy? Because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. If any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. But when you ask, you must believe. You must believe. And have no doubt. Because the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea, blown and tossed by the wind. That person should not expect to receive anything from the Lord. Such a person is double-minded and unstable in all they do. Okay, and this is not just mind over matter or some New Age philosophy, you know, because it's not. I have believed in the Lord, and the Lord has delivered me. I know it. I don't need to habit to explain. In fact, half the things the Lord does for me, I can't explain. But I don't need to. All I need to know is that He loves me and He trusts in Him and He will deliver me. And He has and He will. So, you know, I mean, I've lost count of the number of times I probably should have died, but I haven't. Because of one reason or another. And the reason is I got something to do. The Lord wants me to do something and I will be here until I've done it. And then when I've done it, He'll take me home. Whenever that might be. And hallelujah. I don't know when it will be, but you know, it could be that. See, I found that this scripture, though, it really, really tests you. And in recent weeks, I've been sorely tested to count it all joy with what's been happening to some very good friends of mine. You know, but I've struggled with it, and I've tried to understand the whys of it all. And then, as I've struggled with it, there's come this peace and a knowledge and an understanding that all is well. And that the people we loved are in the arms of the Father. And I as I said, I can't always explain it. I don't always have a reason that I could trot out. It's just that you just have to believe that God knows what is best for us. And He does what is best for us. Sometimes what we think is our best is not quite really good, but you know, but it's good. See, so when you're going through testing times, you've got to remember to keep your altitude up. So your attitude's got to be right. Your attitude's got to be right. I've said before on a previous message, you can either fly with the eagles or cluck with the chickens. You know, and the choice is yours. And God is so good. He gives us choices all the time. All the time He gives you choices. And you can either make a good choice or you can make a bad choice. But the choice is yours. And the consequences of whatever you've decided to do are yours as well. And if you decide on a bad thing and then no good blaming God, if it's what you wanted to do, regardless of that, you know, I mean, I've told you about my beautiful many years ago. After being unemployed, had to get rid of the car because we couldn't afford it, couldn't keep it, blah, 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 all that kind of stuff. Then I got a job, decided that I was going to get a new car. So I went and bought a fantastic car. Sorry to you, Holden guys, but it was a Ford Falcon. But it had everything on it. Bells, whistles, you name it, it had it. It was beautiful. But I wanted that car. God said, don't take it. But I wanted that car. And so I went and bought it. So I bought it on the Saturday. I took it to Mum's on the Sunday. Went to work on the Monday and drove it down to the railway station, Penrith Railway Station. Don't park your car at Penrith Railway Station. Went home Monday, took the car home. Tuesday, drove it back to the station. Came home, came back from work, walked into the car park, walked up to where my car had been parked, and there was nothing there. Gone. Absolutely. They nicked it. I had it for 2 days and it was gone. And when I found it, there was nothing left of it, just a shell. They'd taken everything because it had mag wheels, so they took the mag wheels. It had and what they couldn't take, they broke, you see. So, but the one thing is that I had it insured and the insurance paid for it and everything up. But when I thought about it, the installments to pay for that car were more than I could afford. And I should never have bought it. And if I'd have listened to the Lord, I'd have, you know, I wouldn't have bought it, and I wouldn't have had it stolen, and I wouldn't have gone through all that anger. Because when I found the car, the police told me where the car was. Off I went. I went with my friend Rodney, and while I found the car, whoever nicked it came back. Well, look, Armani, you know. And I was a lot skinnier back then as well, believe it or not. And I was so cranky, I was going to go up to them and have a real right Barney with them. Except my friend, who had more sense than I did, grabbed hold of me, threw me in his car, and off we went. But, you know, you've got to be careful, I guess. But the thing is that sometimes when we see something we want, sometimes everything goes out the window. Common sense, everything else, all goes out the window. And you must have that thing, regardless of what it might be. So sometimes you really need to make sure that you're talking to God and you're in tune with what God wants you to do. All right. You see, right at this present point of time, when it comes to faith, I find there are many people whose faith is wavering. You know, and even to the point of evaporating into thin air. You know, I was just talking at one of the last regional meetings we went to, and one of the big churches, the president of the state, he's got a fairly large church, and he was saying that he'd lost 15% of his congregation. They'd gone and not come back. So, you know, again, we just need to keep our attitude right. There's no point in blaming God for what's happening. Not his doing. But, you know, I think I've given you enough gloom and doom. Right? Yeah. Agreed? So let me get back to the scriptures that I quoted earlier on. And John 16, verse 33. So Jesus has just finished telling his disciples that they will suffer much for his name and they will be scattered. And this is what he says to them. He says, I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble or tribulation. But take heart, I have overcome the world. Okay. A lot of the time when we read this scripture, we read that last bit. I have overcome the world. And everyone, oh, terrific, yeah. But there is this bit in the front, that there is tribulation. One goes with the other. But take heart. God, Jesus has overcome it all. You see, no matter how bleak the outlook may appear, no matter how dire the situation is that you are facing, Jesus has overcome it all. Jesus gives us a peace that is almost indescribable. He speaks in John 14 about the gift the Father will send and the peace he offers. This is what he says. All this I have spoken while still with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and remind you of everything I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid. See, if you believe the word, if you believe the living word that's written in the Bible, you can have this peace in full measure. I used earlier a portion of John 10:10, and this is what it says in full. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. See, good scripture with a warning. You can't have one without the other, okay? It's nice if we could just live this utopia, but we're in a world. We're in the world, but we're not of the world, okay? That's what the scripture says. We're in it. You can't avoid it. You can't just say like the old, it was an old English show, Stop the World, I Want to Get Off. And, you know, you just simply can't stop the world and step off it. You're in it. But you're in it with Jesus. And if you're in it with Jesus, you're in the majority. Get it right? Okay, you're right. You've got a power that is so indescribable that you've got at the palm of your hands. You can reach out and touch him anytime you like. And if you've got problems, you can reach out to him and he can give you the peace I've been talking about. So I want to finish the message with this song. I want to play this song. Now, I've had it whirling around my head for some time, and the men's group probably know it by heart by now. But it speaks to my soul, and each time I hear it, it gives me encouragement. It gives me confidence that all is well. So what I want you to do, I just want you to just obviously sit and just close your eyes, but listen to the words. Just let the words flood over you. Let them flood into your soul. Let them just resonate within you as you listen to the words of the song. Could you play the song? Thanks, Pete. No. There's a web thing on the on Proclaim. It should be I Speak Jesus. Well, it was there yesterday. I can't sing it because it'll all go running out the door.
Chromebooks are seriously easy to set up right out of the box.
Well,
just sign in with your Gmail and bam.
I will close this down and go close down. Where are you? No, I won't Google it. I shall go. Come on. It's wonderful, but you're not what I want. Go away. Why doesn't it never work when you want it to? Anyway, there you go. Yeah, it's called tribulation, trials and worries. But okay, you sure it's not there? Is it what? Yeah, that's it. Turn it up, please. Here we go. We get there. Technology is wonderful when it works. Anyway, listen to the song.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind, 'cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus. Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadows. Burn like a fire. I just want to speak the name.
Hallelujah. Why don't we stand up this morning, keep our eyes closed, lift our hearts and hands to the Lord, to this song, and respond this morning. Pastor Derek will be praying for people afterwards. We need to do the prayer requests first.
Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every. Speak the holy name, Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains.
I see Jesus.
And Jesus in the streets.
You're going through tribulation right now. You're going through things that are too hard for you. We just want you to look at Jesus this morning. I see Jesus. All those things will melt away as He gives you peace.
Praise the Lord. So, look, if you know Jesus, then you can take heart that He will take care of you, that you can rest in the assurance that He will continue to guide you until you meet face to face.
No day at the beach.
And if you're uncertain where you stand, then Jesus is ready, willing and able to come to you wherever you are and to be the peace that you so desperately need. He stands at the door. All you've got to do is open it.
How a mother to makes a side income of five figures.
Have a great week. And as Pastor Wayne's already said, if you need prayer, then come up to the front and we'll pray. Get somebody to pray for you. We've got prayers with Annie. And then the prayer line's open. So if you want to come, come on out and we'll pray for you. No problem. Well done. Thanks, Annie.
Amen. Thanks. I just want to do another prayer first for the live stream. So just come and hang there. Welcome, Annie. And okay, just if you're watching live stream, you may be seated for a minute. And after we've finished these prayers, which won't take long, the front is open for anyone that needs to come and get some prayer. That'll be good. God's good. And this is, I hope you know, this is Cameron, everyone. He's visiting us this morning. Walk through the door. Get to know him and say hello to him and show him where the coffee is. And if he disappears, don't let him disappear. I think he's going to come to our Wednesday study. He's going to come and Jack and Susan, myself, are running it. So that'll be good. And you're back on, I wanted to advertise that, for Ray and Hazel. They're back on at 6:30 here at the church, and the young adults are meeting, so fortnightly. Yep, so that's good, three groups going. And more groups will get raised up as we grow, and that'll be good. So Just if you're watching via live stream this morning and you don't know Jesus, or maybe you do know Jesus and you've fallen away from him. As Pastor Derek said this morning, you can have a head knowledge or a heart knowledge. You know, in the book of Ezekiel, the Bible says that God gives us a new heart and a new spirit, and he causes us to walk in his statutes. He causes us to walk in his ways. It's not hard. Jesus said, my yoke is easy, my burden is light. And even though there's a challenge for us at times, mentally and emotionally, if we tune in and we look to Jesus, you know, it is easy and hard all at the same time, if you know what I mean. But Jesus is good. So if you're watching by a live stream, let's all bow our head this morning and pray this prayer. It's not a magic prayer, okay, but it is a prayer. If you sincerely mean it, then Jesus will come into your heart this morning. I encourage you to read your Bible, find a place to fellowship somewhere where the Word of God is preached, and I encourage you to pray and have a prayer life and a number of other things that you may be a healthy, fit and witnessing and powerful Christian for the Lord. Jesus is good. Dear Heavenly Father, that's it. Just repeat that after me. I believe in Jesus. I trust Jesus. I thank you that you, Lord Jesus, died on the cross for my sins. And you rose again the third day to give me life, that I might be born anew, that I might be able to walk with you. I am so sorry for all my sins. Cleanse me now with your blood, with your sacrifice, for every human being who would receive you. So I open my heart now, and I ask you into my heart, into my life. I receive you, Jesus. I ask you to help me to follow you, in Jesus' name. Amen. And if you prayed that prayer and you're watching by a live stream anywhere in the world or around the nation and you need some help, just put in the comment section and we'll see what we can do to get you steered in the right direction. God bless you. We're going to open the front now and Pastor... Oh, no, we're not. Annie's going to pray.
Praise the Lord. Let us all stand and reach out for this prayer request this morning. Precious Jesus, thank you, Lord. Father, as we come to you in Jesus' name, we pray, Lord, for Jay this morning in Nara, Lord. We pray that you will give him work, supply all his every needs, Lord. Go before him, Jesus, and bless him, Jesus. We pray, Lord, for Jenny Kay, Lord. We declare healing, complete healing in your name for her body, Lord. Raise her up, Lord. Restore her to good health, Jesus. Oh, Father, go before her, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We pray, Lord, for Dom this morning. We lift him up to you this morning, Jesus. We declare healing over him, Lord. We declare healing in your name, Jesus. Oh, Lord, restore him to good health, Jesus. Go before him. Strengthen him, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Glory to Jesus. We also pray, Lord, for Daniel's dad. He had a fall, Jesus, and he's not really well, Lord. And Lord, Daniel, he loves his dad. And so I pray, Lord, that you will raise Daniel's dad up too, Lord. We pray for his salvation, Lord. We pray that you will draw him to you, Lord. We declare healing for Daniel's dad this morning. Strengthen him and restore him to good health, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Bless his family, Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Thanks, Annie. Amen. Pastor Derek's going to come, and if you need prayer this morning, the altar or the front is open for prayer, and we're happy to pray for you. And, you know, God is I don't have to defend God that he does answer prayers. and he's a wonderful God. And the Bible says, where two or three are gathered in my name and agree, there I am in the midst of them. So it's good to come and receive prayer. And so